Good morning, and welcome to the worship of God at Northside Baptist Church in Clinton, Mississippi, on this third Sunday after Pentecost, both to our in-person worship and to our continuing online worship service. Whether you are gathered here in person, here in the sanctuary, or worshiping online, we are grateful for you. Your presence is a blessing to this congregation. Just a few announcements. We welcome back our pastor, Courtney, and her husband, Michael, who have been away on vacation. Also this week, on June 1st, Tuesday, Courtney marked her third year as our pastor. So we give thanks to God for her and for her ministry among us, and also for Michael's ministry. Very thankful for Michael, and thankful for Ken Anderson for helping us out last week. That was a blessing. As many of you know, in-person Sunday school began today, and I think it was a great success. I think it was wonderful to be together, and I hope that those of you that made it were glad to see each other and be in person for your Sunday school class. We'll continue to tweak that in many different ways. In your bulletin announcement sheet, you have the new health protocols that we're observing, and keep abreast of those as they change. We'll let you know. You may have noticed you didn't get a newsletter in the mail. It's online, but if you missed having a paper copy, just call the office, talk to Heather, and she will mail you one. We're trying to save money and be responsible to the trees and all of that and be having them online. Just a few caregiving updates. Sylvia Smith is still at Lakeland, nursing rehab, recovering from her surgery. And Gail Shelton's husband, Dale Shelton, as many of you know, passed away Thursday evening at Hospice Ministries, and Gail was at his side. His funeral will be in this place this Thursday, June 10th, and there will be a visitation from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., and then the service will be here at 1 p.m. Please join them if you can. If you cannot be here, I know that you will remember them in prayers as those that travel and those that can't travel. Michael will be posting it online, so we're grateful for that. It is good to be here in this place, knowing that the Spirit is among us, moving and drawing us closer to God. So we give thanks, and so now let us worship.
Will you join with me in the summons? We gather today like the crowd around Jesus, waiting and watching for healing. Come, Lord, meet us here. Welcome us as your family. We want to do God's will.
As we gather this morning, let us pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our first reading comes from 1 Samuel. So all the elders of Israel met and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are now old, and your sons do not follow your ways. Appoint us a king to rule us, like all other nations." But their request for a king displeased Samuel. He prayed to the Lord, and the Lord told him, "Listen to the people and all that they are saying. They have not rejected you. It is I whom they have rejected, I whom they will not have to be their king. They are now doing to you just what they have done to me since I brought them up from Egypt. They have forsaken me and worshiped other gods. Hear what they have to say now, but give them a solemn warning and tell them what sort of king will rule over them." Samuel reported to the people who were asking him for a king and all that the Lord had said to him. "This will be the sort of king who will bear rule over you," he said. "He will take your sons and make them serve in his chariots and with his cavalry. And they will run before his chariot. Your slaves, both men and women, and the best of your cattle and your donkeys, he will take for his own use. He will take a tenth of your flocks, and you yourselves will become his slaves. There will come a day when you will cry out against the king whom you have chosen, but the Lord will not answer you on that day. The people, however, refused to listen to Samuel. No, they said, we must have a king over us. Then we shall be like other nations, with a king to rule us, to lead us out to war and fight our battles. And now from 2 Corinthians. But Scripture says, I believed, and therefore I spoke out. And we too, in the same spirit of faith, believe, and therefore speak out. For we know that he who raised the Lord Jesus to life will, with Jesus, raise us too, and bring us to his presence, and you with us. Indeed, all this is for your sake, so that as the abounding grace of God is shared by more and more, the greater may be the chorus of thanksgiving that rises to the glory of God. No wonder we do not lose heart. Though our outward humanity is in decay, yet day by day we are inwardly renewed. Our troubles are slight and short-lived, and their outcome is an eternal glory which far outweighs them, provided our eyes are fixed, not on the things that are seen, but on the things that are unseen. For what is seen is transient, what is unseen is eternal. We know that if the earthly frame that houses us today is demolished, we possess a building which God has provided, a house not made by human hands, eternal and in heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the season after Pentecost, we begin again to confess our sins before God and to lay aside every sin that entangles us. Let us now confess our sins together. Gracious God, forgive us our reluctance to admit and confess our sins. We rationalize our actions, mask our thoughts, distort our intentions, and avoid responsibility whenever we can. We make enemies, bear grudges, call evil good and good evil when it suits us. Lord, you alone can save us. You alone can forgive us and make us whole. My brothers and sisters, now hear these words of assurance of pardon. With the Lord is steadfast love and great power to redeem. In Christ Jesus, our sins are forgiven. Through the Holy Spirit, we may extend grace to others. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning, friends. It's time for children's time for those of us who are in person and those of us who are online. And today's an exciting day, right? How many of you went to Sunday school today? Can you raise your hand? Whoa! How many of you maybe in Sunday school learned a Bible story today? Yeah? Did we learn those things? All right. And it seems like we are so excited that maybe we have some extra wiggles going on. So put one hand in the air, put the other hand in the air, and wave them around like you just don't care. And then maybe put your fingers together and make a wave. Can we make a wave? Can we make a wave? What about can we do a little wave with our fingers? Can we put our fingers up and wave them like you just don't care? And can any of my friends make them wiggle like a worm? Can we make them wiggle like a worm? Y'all are so good at that. Thank you so much. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. I'm so excited to see all of you and to know that some of you are worshiping online with us this morning. So I have a question. Who are you sitting next to right now? Mom. Is anybody else sitting next to their mom right now? Anybody else sitting next to their mom right now? What about somebody sitting next to their dad? Is anybody sitting next to their dad right now? Yeah. What about grandma? Is anybody sitting next to their grandma right now? Yeah. In church, sometimes we sit next to our family, right? And sometimes our families look different. Sometimes our family is our mom. Sometimes our family is our dad. Sometimes our family is our grandparents or our aunts and our uncles. Families are interesting things. There's some things that get us into families. Sometimes we're born into a family. Sometimes we're adopted into a family. When me and Mr. Michael got married, I got a whole new family, part of his family. Today, in our gospel story, Jesus has an encounter with his family. His mom and his brothers are there with him, and they're looking for him. They're worried about him. Now, what happens next is kind of interesting. Jesus looks around him, and he says, "Who are my mother and brothers?" And he says, "Anyone who does the will of God are my mother and brothers." Now, friends, I want you to look farther than just beside you. I want you to look at the people in front of you and the people behind you. Maybe the people who are in the choir loft. If you're at home, maybe the people you see on the screen. Look around you. Jesus says, "This is your family too." Whenever we follow Jesus, we get the choice to have a bigger family, a family of people who do God's will. For us, that's our church family. But did you know there are millions of people around this world who are your family too? Millions of people who believe in Jesus and who want to do God's will. We have a very, very big family. So that's our lesson for today, friends. I'm so glad that you're worshiping with us this morning. I'm so glad you started Sunday school today. Whenever we ask the question, "Who is my family?" I know that I can look out at each one of you and say, "You're my family too." Thanks, friends. Will you join with me in the reading of Psalm 30? "Out of the depths I cried to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared. I wait for you, O Lord. My soul waits. In your word is my hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who keep watch for the morning,
more than those who keep watch for the morning. O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love. With the Lord there is plenteous redemption. For the Lord shall redeem Israel from all their sins.
Please pray with me. God, you know us so well. God of all goodness and grace, you are worthy of a love greater than we can give or even understand how to give. But we know and believe in the love that you bear toward us. In this quiet time, we open our hearts to you, O Lord, knowing that you see not on the outside, but certainly you see deep within. You know our fears and our struggles. You know our insecurities. You know our hopes and our dreams. And you are there, O God, with us. Teach us to dwell in your love, to dwell in you, and welcome you to dwell in us so that we might do your will in all things, especially to love you and to love our neighbor. You know how fickle our allegiances can be and how lacking in good judgment we are. You know how imperfectly we love those you have given us to love and serve. Help us not to lose heart or be discouraged, but to trust that daily you are at work in our lives, drawing us closer to you, teaching us through all things to put our complete trust in you. So teach us to wait and not fear. Teach us to rely on your steadfast love and your power to redeem every situation, everything that we encounter, those things that seem too much for us, the giants that we face, even the little irritations. You are with us and give us strength. Lord, today we remember our scouts who are out in nature. We pray that you bless them, fill them with the joy of being on a camping trip. Keep them safe. We pray for our youth and for Courtney and James as all of them prepare for camp next week. Lord, prepare their hearts to meet with you, to be changed, transformed, made even stronger and wiser, and full of hope and full of the goodness of their own lives. Lord, we pray today for many on our caregiving list. Those that are so weary and struggling to be whole and be well. Surround them, O God, and stretch out your hand to hold them in your love. Today we remember Abby and Sylvia, Pete and Deidre, Allie Jenkins and Blake Parham, Wesley and Jeannie Lane, and others. You know each one by name. Love them and care for them. We remember those who are confined at home or care facilities, be their companions, Thelma, Ladine, Merle, and Deborah. We pray for those who are grieving, for dear Gail Shelton, for Jennifer, Tim, and Maddie, and David, and all of Dale's extended family as they gather to comfort one another. Be present to them and carry them through these days, as well as those whose grief may not be fresh, but still needs your help to bear. We pray also for Bradley Lewis and for Audrey and for Eleanor and for Sandy Lewis in the death of Sandy's mother. Comfort them, we pray. And so today, O Lord, as we receive the gifts of your table, help us receive them with joy, knowing that grace upon grace are the gifts we have received from you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we give you all our thanks. Amen.
And now stand for the reading of the gospel. From Mark chapter 3. He entered a house, and once more such a crowd collected round them that they had no chance even to eat. When his family heard about it, they set out to take charge of him. "He is out of his mind," they said. The scribes, too, who had come down from Jerusalem, said, "He is possessed by Beelzebub, and he drives out demons by the prince of demons." So he summoned them and spoke to them in parables. "How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a household is divided against itself, that household cannot stand. And if Satan is divided and rebels against himself, he cannot stand, and that is the end of him. On the other hand, no one can break into a strong man's house and make off with his goods unless he has first tied up the strong man, and then he can ransack the house. Truly I tell you, every sin and every slander can be forgiven, but whoever slanders the Holy Spirit can never be forgiven. He is guilty of an eternal sin." He said this because they had declared that he was possessed by an unclean spirit. Then his mother and his brothers arrived. They stayed outside and sent in a message asking him to come out to them. A crowd was sitting round him when word was brought that his mother and brothers were outside asking for him. "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he replied. Looking round at those who were sitting in the circle about him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning again, Northsiders and friends. It's wonderful to see you on this first Sunday of a summer sermon series. So I know that you're going to stick here for every single one, right? Everybody's changing their summer plans. Got to stick around for Mark. Week by week, we follow the lectionary, a three-year cycle of scripture texts read by Christians around the world. This year is year B, and for the most part, the gospel readings stay in Mark. So we thought it would be a great opportunity to dig into Mark a little bit deeper, particularly the life and ministry of Jesus from the time he names the 12 until his passion. Mark is the earliest gospel, the shortest gospel, and the gospel that is written like the author has somewhere to be in a hurry. As we explore this gospel, you will notice the word immediately on several occasions. This is how the author moves the story along. But the writer is so quick that it makes translation awkward. This is what Richard A. Horsley writes. The language of the gospel is that of popular spoken Greek. Its style features rapid sequences of brief and vivid concrete episodes linked simply by "and" or "and immediately," frequently omitted in translation for less awkward reading in English. The narrative often shifts from the past to the present tense, enlivening the action. By Horsley's description, Mark sounds like it could easily be converted into a comic strip or a movie storyboard. There is an intensity in Mark, almost an angst, that I think is only punctuated by these vignettes we see of a very human Jesus pointed along the narrative arc of the Son of God. From the start of this series, you also need to know something else. Mark is my favorite gospel. I am unashamed of it. It is also Susan's favorite gospel. It is also Sam Drummond's favorite gospel. And I hope by the end of the series, selfishly, that some of you will fall in love with Mark too. I have wrestled this week with how much of an introduction to the series I ought to do and how much work we should do with the rich scripture text we have today, Mark 3, 20 through 35. And what I've landed on is that the scripture text for today is to be a model of our posture for the rest of the sermon series. Verse 3:34 begins this way, "And looking at those around him." And looking at those around him. Looking at those around him. Just as Jesus is in the thick of his ministry, look at those around you now. Our challenge, not just for this week, but for each week of the series, is to be those who Jesus sees around him. I want us to stick with Jesus this summer, to hear his parables and see his miracles as if it was the first time. As much as it is possible, I would like us to have our feet firmly planted in Mark and encounter Jesus with fresh ears, fresh eyes, like those hearers did in 70 CE, before the other Gospels were even written. I use the word challenge because it will be challenging for us, and there's a few things that could get in our way, namely taking the posture of either Jesus' family or the religious authorities on this journey. Initially, we may think of Jesus' family's reaction as pretty harsh. We may see them interfering with his ministry or ready to restrain Jesus from the work he is called to do because they think he has lost it. However, Dr. April Holke Simpson, in her assessment on this passage, read Jesus' family's involvement as one of care. Even in the strong verb translated as to restrain, she notes other places in this gospel where that verb is used in a positive situation, both in 5:41 and 9:27. She argues that Jesus' family is trying to help him in a moment of frustration. Think of this scene that Jesus' family walks up on. Jesus is being so crowded by the crowd that he cannot even eat. He cannot even eat. Just a few verses before, in verse 9, Jesus has to teach from a boat so the crowd would not crush him on the shoreline. Imagine if you were Jesus' mother and brothers in that moment. This 32-year-old man whom you love is nearly crushed on multiple occasions. Of course they would want him to take a break. Of course they would question his career that is hindering his health. Wouldn't you check in on him too if you saw that your brother or son was working so hard there wasn't even time or space to eat? Hokie Simpson even regards the phrase, "he is beside himself," with compassion. She writes this, "Here, he is beside himself implies that Jesus is behaving atypically, perhaps agitatedly, because the crowd is now so intense that he and his disciples cannot meet their own basic needs. This translation allows that Jesus' family acts to help him during that moment of frustration. More importantly, though, even if Jesus' family is understood to question Jesus' sanity and undercut his ministry, with good intentions or not, in 3:21, the scene still underscores that Jesus' public momentum, in a situation where his legitimacy is publicly called into question, Jesus redefines his family and associates himself with any who would follow him with the will of God. So what does this mean for us? I think in this Markan journey, we can be well-intentioned, just like Jesus' family in our approach. We may want to protect Jesus. We may want to explain away his difficult teachings. We may want him to act more appropriately, even less aggressively. If we sit with Jesus in this season, Jesus will make us uncomfortable. Like I mentioned before, Mark is my favorite gospel. But that does not mean I like everything Jesus says in the Gospel of Mark. It challenges me. For Jesus to do the will of God in the Gospel of Mark, he needed to challenge his family's notion of who he was. He could no longer be the little boy they may have reminisced over. And like that, too, Jesus will challenge our images of him that we have treated nostalgically over the years, too. Jesus ain't a precious moments figurine. He will crack. Not the real Jesus, the image we have built up. Another group in this passage are the scribes who have come from Jerusalem. Before the scripture passage, Jesus has already run in with the religious authorities many times. And mind you, we are only in chapter 3. Back in chapter 2, Jesus was already accused of blasphemy once, then later judged by the scribes and Pharisees for eating with tax collectors and sinners, and again while gathering grain on the Sabbath. We are only in chapter 3, and religious officials are already fed up with him, to the point the authorities, not just from Capernaum, but from Jerusalem, are called in. Jesus is already dealing with the heavy hitters. Commentator Wendy Farley writes this, "It is natural to identify with the church authorities. If we are preaching in a church, or sitting on committees, choosing hymns, organizing Sunday school and potlucks, we are part of the church authority." That's us, y'all. She continues, "Christianity usually puts Christ at the base of the structures and uses his authority to bolster theirs. But this story demands a different perspective because it is the very people that are condemned for failing to recognize who Jesus is. Like Jesus' family, I think the religious authorities had concern to protect what they cared for too, their religion, their practices, customs, and worship that delivered their people from captivity and sustained them through the multiple foreign occupations. And perhaps we can understand this too. many of us feel like the practices, customs, and worship that have sustained us are under attack. We see record numbers of people leaving church in our country, and we are tempted to grab hold of what we have and what we have known and not let go. Our challenge for this journey of Mark is to resist the urge to be the religious authorities too, to preserve what we think we know of our religion when Jesus will inevitably challenge us otherwise. What Jesus does in this scripture is strip away all of the assumptions that others have of him in this moment, both his family and the religious leaders. And he asks us to do that too, to strip away those layers of theology and assumptions from other gospels and be with him now as he is. Yes, those layers we have built on, sometimes decades of relationship with Jesus, can be good. But what I don't want to do is to have them hinder us from seeing Jesus as he is presented in Mark. What I do not want is those layers to hinder us from having a real and memorable encounter with Jesus Christ, the Son of God, this summer. This is a scary proposition. A scary proposition. Hear Wendy Farley's warning of the original listeners. For these people, Jesus' disordered love of humanity feels like falling off a cliff into chaos best symbolized by the demonic or insanity. You may be thinking, Courtney, what are you getting us into? I don't want to feel like I'm falling off a metaphorical cliff. Okay, let's temper the situation a little bit, because there are also two groups in this scripture who I think can guide us in a more positive direction: the crowd and the disciples. First are the disciples. Feme Perkins, in the introduction to the Gospel of Mark in the New Interpreter's Bible, describes the role of the disciples not necessarily as concurrent with Jesus' mission, as it is in Matthew or Luke, but their role is to be with him and to accompany Jesus in his ministry. Ultimately, the 12 disciples named just before our scripture today, earlier in Mark 3, would fail at their role in this gospel, because in the end, they flee. So perhaps rather than regard the disciples as a model in this journey through Mark, we ought to regard them as our mirror. They show us doubt and confusion and running away and strictness to religion and disappointment, and in seeing those things in them, we can see them in ourselves. The second group we can aim after is the crowd. At times, the crowd is a little much. They live up to their name and literally crowd Jesus and demand much of him. And we, if we are honest, are known for those things sometimes too. But the crowd also represents a wild openness to followership of Jesus. The members of the crowd are not named or individualized, and yet they are called Jesus' family. They will not have the word saint or apostle put in front of their name, but they are taught and healed and fed like those 12 named disciples were. The combination of the crowd and the disciples together is where I would like for us to find ourselves throughout the summer. Those are the one who Jesus sees around him. My friend who I quoted earlier, Dr. Holke Simpson, suggested an article to me called Fallible Followers, Women and Men in the Gospel of Mark by Elizabeth Struthers Malbon. It was so informative and life-giving to me that I recommend it to each member of our church. I even put a link in your email on Friday, and Heather is tired of me turning to her in the middle of the week and saying, you need to listen to this one more quote. So please read it if you're at least interested. Malvin's article goes through particulars of some of these fallible followers, but for this Sunday, I find her analysis of the crowd and the disciples together is able to propel us forward as a church. She writes this: were only the disciples depicted as followers, the demands of discipleship would be clear, but discipleship might appear restrictive. Were only the crowd depicted as followers, the outreach entailed in following Jesus would be clear, but the followership might appear permissive. with both disciples and the crowd depicted as fallible followers. The Mark and narrative message is plain. Discipleship is both open-ended and demanding. Followership is neither exclusive nor easy. This morning, may we begin this Markan journey by finding ourselves seen by Jesus in his line of sight, mixed up with the crowd and the disciples. May we find ourselves in his home, where there is space for everyone born, where grace saves and where demands of followership challenge us. When asked the question, who is my mother? Who is my brother? May we look around and see the kindred of Christ. And may it be so in our lives. Amen. As we enter into the time of communion, remember that this is not Northside's table, but it is God's table. And God's table is strong enough to carry any of your burdens. And God's table is wide enough to welcome all people. And God's table is level enough to give us a foretaste of the justice of the kingdom of God. And so we give you thanks that on the night of his arrest, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Thanks be to God for this holy gift.
In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith."
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory.
remain standing for the offering prayer. God, we give you this offering and pray that you would use it to provide for the poor, to comfort the mourners, to minister to the meek, to feed the hungry, and to provide mercy and peace for those who are persecuted. Help us to serve these whom you have blessed, for you have loved us, and in your grace have given us more than we need. Amen.
My hope and my prayer is that you have worshiped God fully, whether you've been with us in person or worshiped with us online. And I just want to take a moment of gratitude to tell you all thank you for letting me be your pastor for the last 3 years. I'm so excited for what God has in store for our church. Would you receive this blessing? Know that you have been welcomed here, not in spite of who you are, but precisely because of who you are, a beloved child of God. And as you leave this place, do the will of God. For if you do, you will be regarded as the family of Christ. Go in peace to love and serve our God. Amen.